thank you all here, Victor and Jorik. We will talk about application services, in particular low-code. Victor is founder and chief engineering officer of Thinkwise, and Thinkwise is a Dutch low-code platform provider and is recognized by Forrester as one of the 13 leaders in the market as important contender. And we will discuss the current situation of low-code after a brief movie. Victor did University of Delft, worked as an ERP supplier, and was confronted with DOS Windows migration, and then it was the trigger to think about low-code, understood from previous discussions. And he had some visit in Redmond in Microsoft, where he was also confronted with his same ideas he had about Software Factory. So Thinkwise is already 17 years as a company, and started 2.5 years ago to license their platform. So that's new, but that's a cliffhanger. First, a quick movie on what low-code is. A brief overview. That overview, well, first try to,
First, I would like to introduce myself. My name is Miriam Bogaert. I work as an application developer at Advanced Programs. I'm also a software engineer student.
Organizations today spend millions on legacy applications and wait months to get them delivered. But the same application can be built in days and at a fraction of the cost involved in traditional development. How? The secret is low-code. Like the name suggests, it requires drastically fewer lines of code to produce the same result as a traditional programming language. To understand how low-code works, we should first talk about abstraction. Abstraction is a software concept that handles complexity by hiding unnecessary details, like the gears in these cars. One's an automatic and the other a manual. With an automatic, you don't need to worry about the complex backend. Low-code technology is similar. You can implement custom logic on an already abstracted layer without even thinking about the underlying complexity. In today's world, a business needs digital tools to succeed and function efficiently. That's why cloud software is on the rise. But packaged applications don't always cater to your requirements. Even customizing them can be pricey. Low-code clears these roadblocks and helps you stay ahead. How, you ask? Low-code empowers you to build custom solutions 10 times faster, with a wide range of functionalities like an intuitive visual builder, ready-to-use code snippets, form and report templates, and pre-built integrations. Low-code platforms eliminate the cost involved in creating frameworks and databases. And that's not all. Low-code enables IT teams to trust citizen developers to build necessary apps with minimal technical debt. Low-code helps you get rid of application backlogs and deliver web and mobile applications at the speed of your business. With low-code, spend more time creating and building and less time on repetitive work. Try low-code for yourself and revolutionize the way your business works.
But what is low-code according to a leading organization? The definition according to Gartner is that low-code platforms support rapid application development, deployment, execution, and management using declarative, high-level programming abstractions. These platforms provide and support user interfaces, business processes, and data services. The primary goal is increased productivity with reduced skill set requirements for developers.
But what is no-code? A no-code platform is a tool for building software applications without coding. No-code builder Bryce Vernon compares tools with Lego. According to Bryce, a no-code platform only gives the option to change colors, text, and move components around. Much like Lego, the spirit of no-code is to empower builders. The building blocks come in small pieces that don't need much in isolation, and you don't manufacture the blocks themselves. No coding necessary.
Let's take a look at the way that technology has developed over the years. IT application development has been on an evolutionary journey since the 90s. Many of these early programs used the go-to instruction as a code reuse technique, which created spaghetti code that made programs difficult to debug and maintain.
In the 90s, object-oriented technology also began to be accepted.
New languages such as C++ and Java grew in popularity. These languages usually came with an IDE, libraries, and were descendants of older languages.
A big driving philosophy was programmer productivity.
Many companies have adopted this technology for application development, and the tremendous application migration from legacy systems to this technology is still a process.
And that's where low and no code come in. This picture shows the general architecture of a low-code platform. This platform uses abstraction. It will only show what is essential. Therefore, the architecture can be chopped into three parts. First, we have the top layer. Visualization. Development of user interface is mostly done visually. Screen layout can be configured for multiple platforms, such as mobile or browser-based. The middle layer is logic. Standard development procedures are done for you. In some platforms, functionality can be easily reused, as it can be packed in modules. The lowest layer is data storage. Metadata is packed to make it easier for it to be used in the platform.
You all have heard about organizations like Uber or Airbnb. These are called disruptors. No-code and low-code platforms are the current disruptive technology industry trends. In a survey held by OutSystems, respondents are asked about the main reasons for using low-code in their organizations. Their top three goals were accelerate digital innovation and transformation, reduce current IT backlog and increase responsiveness to the business, Reduce dependency on hard-to-hire technical skills.
Here are some differences between low and no code. One of them is the coding skills needed. Low code requires some coding skills. With no code, you don't need these skills.
But what are the benefits of using a low and no code platform?
A huge benefit is speed of development. The key purpose is to write faster code and reduce the duration of the release cycle of a product. Another benefit is auto-deployment and testing. Low-code platforms automate the process of testing and deployment.
Using low and no-code platforms also come with disadvantages.
One of them is shadow IT. With low code, these applications can exist without knowledge of the IT department.
And that poses many risks.
Another one is security. Working with low code means you don't have complete control. And this could lead to security breaches and less variability. There are many providers for low and no code platforms. So how do you pick the right one?
All these platforms have their own expertise and use cases.
For example, Microsoft offers powerful features for developing web and mobile user experience, a big catalog of integration adapters, and an ability to excel in scripting tools that business developers will appreciate.
The sole focus of ThinkWise is use low-code platforms to modernize application, manage finance, inventory, production, and other core business systems.
Forrester expects the market for low-code platforms to increase to $21 billion by 2022. Gardner estimates that by 2024, low-code applications will be responsible for more than 65% of application development activity. So code firms predict a huge future for low and no-code platforms.
Okay. With a lot of thanks of Mirjam Bogaert, a low-code developer at Advanced Programs, who has a 10-year history in planning administration and is also studying at the Haagse Hogeschool. Another applied sciences university student, and she's currently working at low-code, and there was a lot of work, I must say, to compress a lot of low-code information in one little film. Please remind that you can use Mentimeter to have an interaction. So what comes to mind on low-code, please put in your remarks. We come back with different questions in Mentimeter, so be actively involved. It's easier that way, or otherwise you only sit and listen, and I found that tough. I don't know how you think about this, Victor. Victor, a brief question. If you look at either the movie or the word cloud, what keeps in mind? Elaborate a little bit on what you found from the movie, for instance.
I think the movie was pretty impressive because it's hard to summarize low code in such a short time. So, and also to make a difference between no code and low code. I agree a lot on that no code to compare it with Lego. I think the low code part, I missed a little bit the modeling part. I think low code is a lot about modeling and using less code, but the model should be in the center.
Can you elaborate a little bit on that, Victor? Because there's a lot of talking about abstractions and models. Can you give some examples on what do you think about models and abstractions in low code? It's very difficult to grasp.
No, I think the last 30 years or so in the software development industry, we changed the programming language pretty often. We used COBOL or RPG. And then we moved over to official programming languages such as Visual Basic and then C Sharp. And now we end up with React. And most of the time when you change technology, then also the programming language has to change. And the programming language has become more abstract and more abstract, and that helps us definitely. But you can also describe your application with models. And that's even better, because a model, you can maintain a model better. You can query a model to see if the quality is right. So I think then the next level will be the models, and it's not very strange when you look at other high-tech industries. They all use models. When you look at the automotive of the aerospace or building a skyscraper, they all use models, and you can always check your model, and the model is being used by robots to build those end products automatically. So I think the model-driven approach, what we nowadays call low code, is just the same as we learn from other high-tech industries. I don't think the software industry is a high-tech industry when you write millions of lines of code. It's very hard to guarantee the quality. And this is definitely the next step.
Yeah. Okay. Can you elaborate a little bit on how you came with to start ThinkWise? As a Dutch company with a lot of competition of international parties and...
I don't know. There was not... the competition part was not that hard, I think. But, when we started in 2002, the word low-code was not invented yet. The low-code... John Reimer of Forrester invented the low-code word in 2014. And I think the low-code players, such as Mendix or OutSystems or ThinkWise, they all started around 2002, 2005. So it was more a reaction on. In that period we had 4GL. That's also an abstraction layer.
No doubt.
And then Java and C Sharp came up, and with a lot of marketing effort, and so 4GL died a little bit. And I think that those low code players, they disagreed on that, and they tried to make it more mature, and that was the next level.
If low code will enter the same faith as 4GL did. Well, I was still young and angry looking at 4GL at that time, and then it vanished within 10 years.
Good question. I don't think so. When you look at 4GL, then it was more like you had the model, and you had to generate your code from the model, and then you had to maintain your generated code, and you had to maintain your model at the same time, and it was difficult to continue. So it was a little bit immature. and hard to proceed, especially for the larger applications. And most of the time you end up programming anyway after you had the jump start with your model, but you end up programming. But with the platforms we have nowadays, they are much more mature. I mean, productivity increases by factor 10 or even 20. I mean, that's proven. That's not a commercial talk. That's already been proven. So no, I don't think this will go away. And it's also confirmed by what Forrester and Gartner expects.
And if you brief, and before I look at the main drivers and what the audience think about it and what you think about it, we'll react on that. Please continue if you want to add something on the main drive of low-code audience. If you would position what a fairly peculiar, low-code is a Dutch thing. The Dutch were very early adapters in low-code.
Yeah, that's true.
The European were early adapters with OutSystems and Mendix, our European, Portuguese, and Dutch players. And you're also a Dutch player.
Betty Blocks as well. I mean, Betty Blocks, Mendix used to be Dutch, yes, now German. But Betty Blocks is Dutch. We are Dutch. I mean, I think.
Why is that?
Yeah, I think Dutch people are. They have a lot. We have a lot of inventors. I mean, and we don't follow the rules in this country. We want to be different. We want to. So we invent things, and that's really we don't like to follow the mainstream. So I think it's not strange that the Netherlands is really a central place in low code. Yeah.
And what's interesting is that we are an inventor. When I previously had Rob Elsinga from Microsoft, and I will tell him in this debate that we are the inventors and you buy us, more or less. This may be an interesting quote to use at the debate.
Okay.
How they perceive if they are inventors or not. Interesting, though, the quantum computing Microsoft does in the Netherlands is with Delft. Yeah, the Dutch do the quantum computing for Microsoft. Interesting, though, very, very peculiar as we are inventors. But is it also a European thing then? Because OutSystems is Portuguese, I remember.
Maybe, I don't know. I mean, it's a little bit difficult now because everybody jumps on the word low code. So suddenly, existing applications are relabeled as low code. So you really have to be a little bit careful with that to see what it really does. Because there are a lot of low code platforms enters the market, but you really have to see if it is. So if it is model driven, how low code is low code? I mean, you should really see productivity increase with a factor 10 and not with 30%.
I want to give the audience that we react on what they input, and because you have a lot of questions coming up, and you can have open questions too. So still you have time to get interaction with Victor or Jorik if you want to. What are the main drivers for low code? What the audience thinks is first, and second, the mutual place, current software platforms are not quick enough. Mm-hmm. Time to market in brackets. Mm-hmm. And the shortage of software development stars are the main topics why low code is so popular. Mm-hmm. And on the bottom, insufficient business requirement input and COVID-19 like economic pressures. Interesting though, this from Microsoft, do a bit research about it, that in the credit crisis and in the COVID crisis, the demand for low code increased rapidly.
Okay.
So that's the trend there, but probably not the most important trend. Jorik or Victor, do you agree on the main drivers?
Yeah, I think so. I mean, there's always a demand to be faster. There's always a demand for people that make things go faster. But I'm also interested in other things that slow our time to market, because I think low code solves a piece of it. But if I have a ton of legacy, then it might not actually help me right away.
Now, and what's interesting though is a lot of low code providers say, need less business people, or you can put business people in coding. Yeah. It's more or less make it easier for requirements from the business. But maybe that is misunderstood. So
I think it also depends who you ask. I mean, so a lot of low-code platforms, or definitely the no-code platforms, they are used to build apps on top of core systems. And of course, those smaller apps you can probably build as from a business point of view. But your core application, I don't know if you should have that built by the business. Because I think there's a little bit more involved. It's the same as when I'm in a plane. I mean, I can adjust a few things around my seat, and I can optimize my seating position. But I don't know if I should design the engine.
Yeah.
Because I'm not an expert.
If you want to typify ThinkWise, what's your sweet spot at ThinkWise? Because you're a small company in Holland, and you have to compete with heavyweights in money.
Yeah, that's true. But I mean, you introduced us, and that was well done, that we are within the 13 most important vendors named by Forrester. But I think more importantly, we are the only one within those 13 who are capable or building and replacing core applications. So the most of the low code and the no code vendors, they aim at the apps, the smaller apps, and to make to support citizen development, and we really aim at the core application, and that's. So we have to provide some different capabilities, and one of them is very important, that it's that we can migrate to new technology without having to rebuild the application again. Yeah. So that is really a unique selling point of ours, and you need that, because when you build an application that should last for maybe 20 or 30 years, then you have to be able to migrate to new technology, otherwise you will create legacy immediately.
Are there specific domains where you are good at,
We support the business processes. So I think we are. My background is in the ERP, and from my business partner as well. But it is more than ERP. The core. It's really the core applications. And when you describe it in a technical way, then you could say the there should be a database, a business layer, a presentation layer, interfaces to other applications. But then on a large scale, so basically the applications which we build are contain a couple of hundreds or a couple of thousands of entities. So if you
can elaborate a little bit on the future, how does low code, in your opinion, look in the future? If we go a couple of years further, how low code will change?
Yeah, I think it will increase market share, definitely, but it gives us a few other capabilities we never had. I mean, especially when you look at me, because no code was compared with Lego, and I agree on that. But low code, when it is model driven, and when the model is really the definition of your application, then you can change the model very easily, and with that you can change your application very easily. So, an application is capable of being self-learning. You can learn on how it's being used. You can learn to compare it with other companies in your community, it has become very easily to change your software, and we can do it right now. I mean, we can, when you work with an application built with our platform, then you can switch on learning capabilities, and when we show it to prospects, then they are really impressed. And the first question they ask, especially when they are of my age, is, can we switch it off? Because they are a little scared. And I think they are a little scared that the software is changing all the time, but it's changing in your advantage.
Victor, what's the technology behind it? Is it machine learning? Are you what are you using?
Yeah, you can use machine learning for that, but you can also have simpler. It is a combination of rules and machine learning. It depends on how far you will go. But what we do is that we can learn from a single user. We cannot learn from a community yet, but that's the way to go. And you can also, and Mendix uses this as well, especially within the platform, to draw conclusions on how models are being built. So I think this is something we can add to low code, and maybe this can result in that we need, for instance, less requirements, because we define the product halfway, the most important features, and the other half will be learned by using it.
I want to brief, get the audience again to do a Mentimeter. But cliffhanger already is, I want to look about self-learning software, self-learning communities, and future cloud capabilities. But I'll come back on that. Here are some low-code platform quotes. Will eliminate shallow IT. This low-code will eliminate shallow IT. Self-server software development despite complexity of business. Yeah, so low-code is possible despite the complexity of the business. Code explosion, we can only conquer by an app diet. Low-code is not a turning point, but always hard work. Low-code means vendor lock-in. No-code is citizen is the citizen development breakthrough. The last is very interesting. I saw some internet remarks where citizens developers were checked, and about 90% of the citizens developers were actually professional developers in free time. So okay. It was a little bit tricky from what, how do you perceive citizens developer?
Yeah, right.
Please enter your entries in Mentimeter if you want discussion. After this, we have open questions. So if you want to ask Jorik or Victor an open question on any subject in software development, please do remind that question.
Can I ask something? Can I add something to this? Because of course. When I see low code means vendor lock in. I think I agree on that. Although I'm a vendor, right, but alternative. The alternative is that we create developer lock in.
Yeah.
And I think maybe a developer likes it, but I don't know if the business owner likes it. So there's always, yeah. I mean, when you build a program with two or three developers, and you have a million lines of code, then you can of course hire a developer with the skills of the same programming language, but they have to learn all that millions lines of code. So yeah. When you change one out of three developers, then you have a huge problem already. So you have always developer lock-in, and with the platform that will be less, but of course you get a vendor lock-in. I mean, that's definitely true.
To tag on to that, do you see the open source community coming up with anything in low code? Because then I would have a platform lock-in, but at least not a vendor lock-in.
That's true. Yeah, that could be the way to go. That could be the way to go.
What is interesting, though, is that code explosion we can only conquer by an app diet. Yeah, so our appetite for functionality is huge, and appetite for that is huge. Yeah, and until now, it's the most important liked quote. Strongly agree. And then low code means vendor lock-in, and well, the vendor itself agree on that, but still we use it because it's fast. But and then after that, on the second place is self-service is complexity of business. Oh, what changes now? It is now low code means vendor lock-in, and low code citizens development is a breakthrough. Are on the same second par. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So interesting. I like that one though. Is that because as we have previous talks, Victor, is that you see that there will be demand for functionality with humongous, and we need low code to run in that demand anyhow and still get behind.
Yeah, but I think if there's a business case for functionality, and the business cases are getting better by low code because we are faster. So it's easier to make money with new functionality. So yeah. I think that the demand for new functionality will increase. So I don't get the point of going to a functionality diet, if that's the point here, because I think that's the way to go to improve your business and to increase your market.
Yeah.
But we should be able to build it faster and maybe to last, I mean, we write software over and over again with every technology. So that's something what we try to avoid, that you can use your software a longer period and keeping it up to date. Because that's the other, we need a lot of software, but we rewrite software all the time. I mean, for decades, we rewrite the same software in another technology. I mean, that's really a waste of time.
Yeah, true. Maybe I will turn for open questions, so you can now have open questions for Victor and Jorik. Victor, you made a remark when we had a preview discussion about self-learning communities. What's your take about that? What's your
I mean, with a community, when you have, and you see it also with other low-code vendors. I mean, when you have defined your platform, then different customers build different models, but they could learn from each other, and you can compare it, and you can compare models. So and they should allow to learn from each other, because sometimes they would like to protect their own model because it's unique for their business. But if they're open to share it and to compare it, then you can end up with some best practices for certain parts of models, and that's a learning part.
Yeah. Some sort of GitHub for low-code stuff. Mm-hmm. What I'll come to some questions. Is low-code more used by small, medium enterprises or big enterprises? What's your take on that?
Ooh,
question from the audience.
I don't know honestly if there are figures for that. But I think most of the time the low-code platforms are used for building the smaller applications on top of a core application. In that way, ThinkWise is kind of an exception because we aim for the core application. So although we all try to solve the same problem, and that's that there's a very rigid core system which you cannot change. I mean, when you have a rigid COBOL application without development tower anymore, or you have implemented SAP, then you cannot change a lot anymore. And then you will end up with putting apps on top of that. So I think if there's common ground, then you see that it's not depending on the size of the company, but more that they build smaller apps on top of that. That is mostly used. But I think our goal is to replace the core system.
Yeah. Other interesting, is there a marketplace for models?
Oh, definitely. Oh, that's one of my favorites. Yeah.
Of your favorites. Well, good question, audience. You have favorites here.
Yeah, we have at least at ThinkWise we have our own what we call inspiration room. So in our inspiration room we share model parts and we share best practices, but that's from our own idea, and we encourage our customers also to share models. And we are thinking at the moment we think of turning the inspiration room in a kind of marketplace where partners of ours can sell their models to our clients. So I definitely think that there's a market for it. Yeah.
Okay. So there's an opportunity, so to say, to do that.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah.
And also in the question, probably from a teacher or a student, what should the Fontys ICT do? Change the curriculum to prepare students for better for this low-code future. What should they do?
At least introduce low-code platforms as part of their education. And I think the best thing, I mean, it was a while ago when I studied, but when I learned about data modeling, then I had to build a data model on a paper and some teacher judged my data model, but I never saw the impact of my model, if it was right or wrong.
That has changed. We here at Fontys, we do ICT in practice is what we preach.
Uh-huh.
So that's okay.
So when you
see also a lot of students from other applied sciences university, you see difference in the way they appreciate low code in their curricula.
I think they use it more and more, and also the low code vendors try to convince universities to use their platforms. So it's on both sides. I think the universities should use the low-code platform, but vendors are willing to provide them as well.
What's also an interesting question, there's a typically high-code question, I think. I expect there's a high-code student behind this.
Uh-huh.
Are there any clear signs in a project where low-code solutions are not possible? Why can you? Where you say about people do not low code?
No, but low code as well. But I mean, because it really depends on your domain. As mentioned earlier, our domain are really database applications. So when you want to write, when you write a data interface between the two databases or service layers, then the ThinkWise platform is not suitable for that. Or, or if you want to build a game, then the ThinkWise platform is not suitable for that. So you're always focused on a certain domain.
But the game is a really good example. Because 10 years ago, everybody was designing their own engines and implementing their own 3D engines. And nowadays, basically, writing a game is low code.
Definitely.
It's a different domain, but it has gone through the exact same transition. That's really
definitely
cool.
Yeah. When I was...
Before we start the debate, in the next session, I have Colin Wu, who's a game designer.
Okay.
Some remarks on low-code typicalities in gaming. So
maybe one remark, because the gaming, I like this comparison, because when you have a 3D engine, then your model is all the coordinates you use to define the real world. So I think the gaming industry was ahead of the business applications, because we built it manually, and the gaming industry was furthering that. When I graduated, I wanted to graduate on a game, and it was refused because it was not professional.
Maybe you had then not a ThinkWise but a real gaming platform.
Maybe that influenced my future at all.
Another interesting question for you both is what are the most important skill of a low-code developer?
Ooh. I think you have different roles, so you still have the requirements, and there's no coding skill at all, because we build large applications. You still have data modeling, you still have UI is I think was a little bit not that strong, because everything is model driven, so you don't have all that freedom. And then you have your business rules, and sometimes they're modeled and sometimes they're programmed. So we see different roles in a project, and some people can do all the roles themselves, but it's not necessary that you can do them all when you are in a team.
Ik heb nog één, I have no 1 minute.
Okay.
So I will maybe for now, I think they're not ready though. Thank you all for your attention. Thank you for all your questions. There is a market outside again. There is a next session, a debate, where Victor and Rob Elzinga from Microsoft are again, and Jorik is also there, and two students, a typical low-code student and a high-code student, young and eager. Come and see us.